Okay. Thank you, Mr. DJ. Thank you. So our program is about starting. Thank you very much. Thank you. Hello, everybody. Host, can you please stop sharing the screen for now? Thank you. Hello, everybody. Good evening once more. I trust we are all doing great. My name is Fiasam Linda Dalali, a student of UESTC, a first year PhD student from the School of Software Engineering. I welcome you all and I'll be your moderator for the entire program. Okay, so with that being said, I would also like to remind students of UESTC who have currently joined the program to please change your Zoom ID to your student, your name, that is your first name, and then your student number. Meanwhile, all other participants are warmly welcome. In fact, we are so excited that you joined our program for us all to learn together, to get some tidbits about, you know, research and all. So welcome once more. So I would like to take this opportunity to welcome a few people. Just a moment. So I would like to welcome a few people. So first of all, this is the program that we are about having, Roadmap to Academic Success, which is proudly organized by the National Union of Ghana Students, Chengdu, in collaboration with the ISO of UESTC. And we welcome you once again. So this will be our outline for the entire program. So first of all, I would like to introduce a few dignified personalities amongst us. And the first two people I would like to introduce to you are our speakers. So, but before I proceed, the program is in two sessions, okay? The first session is from 8:15 to 9 p.m., after which we will have a Q&A session. Then we have the second session, which is from 9:30 to 10 p.m. Trust me, you're really going to enjoy this program because the speakers are well informed. I mean, they are so good. So guys, just sit tight, relax, and enjoy every bit of it, okay? So let's look at our speakers. First of all, I'd like to introduce you to our one and only Professor Ninxie, who is an associate professor at the School of Computer Science and Engineering, who is at the Center for Future Media at UESTC. And our second, the next speaker is Dr. Benjamin Kluger Brown, who is currently pursuing his postdoc at the University of Electronic Science and Technology of China at the School of Life Science and Technology, and he is at the Brain Connectivity Lab. I would also like to draw attention to the fact that although Professor Ninxie is supposed to be our first speaker, but due to some delays, he will join us later for the second session. But the first person to start will be our first speaker, our second speaker, Dr. Benjamin Kluger Brown. So without much ado, I would like to give the floor to Doc. So Doc, if you are ready, please kindly take over. Thank you.
Can you all see me? Hello?
Hello, Doc. Yeah, I can see.
Okay. And can you hear me? Can you hear me clearly?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, Doc, we can hear you clearly.
All right.
All correct.
We can see. Thank you all for joining in this seminar or webinar. Actually, this is a program organized by the NUGS, that's students from Ghana, but then they saw it important to invite other international students since this is an academic activity. So this my side of the presentation is going to be in two folds. One will be some theories regarding the how to do literature review or literature search. And then the second part is going to be a practical section where I'll try to take you through some databases, how to optimize your search in the databases that we have available on campus or worldwide. So I will now share my PPT. So I want to remind all of you that this program is an interactive one. So we would like, so after this, we would like members to really, you know, engage us in understanding the process of doing research. So it's not going to be like I'm going to talk and then you guys listen and then that will be all, but it's going to be, I hope that it becomes an interactive one and then interesting for all of us. So like the MC said, and she has already introduced me, and so I'll quickly jump to the content of this PPT. So first of all, we are going to look at the general overview of research reviews, which will basically be a sum or a summary of what literature review is, and then some steps to follow when you are going to do your literature review. And then we will go to the practical side. So it's just basically two things. We'll do theory and then we'll go to practicals. And I hope that by the end of this seminar, everyone is going to have something under their sleeves for the next years coming in their research life. So if you guys are ready, then I will proceed. All right. Now, you can see the question is that most people ask you why the need for literature review. So for instance, when I come to school and I meet my professor, I should be able to directly jump into my research. But the most important thing you should know is that you don't know everything in the research field. Perhaps a lot of people have done the same thing that you are thinking about. So first you need to go through the literature to find out what has been done or what is going on. So if you look at this, this graph, this chart here, you can see that at the y-axis, we have amount of published research. And then x-axis, we have amount of literature review. So that means you can see that if we have less research here, but more review, then at this part, we have more research that has been published, but less review. So what does that tell us? It tells us that there is kind of gap between what has been done already and what is going on. So even if we do the review and we publish a review, we still need to review what has been reviewed. So you can see this part says that the need for review of reviews. That means we need to update what the story that has been told over the years, because a review is just like a story to tell people what has been done. So we need to update what has been done over the years. And then we complement it with new research. So when you are updating, the new ideas comes in because you're definitely going to find some gaps in the research along the years. So that once we know this fact, then let us see the concept of what literature review actually is. So this might sound trivial, but it is important. Literature review is actually, I must say, the most difficult part for most students and even most researchers. Because imagine that you are in a field that is as old as the research itself. So you have some fields that date back, you know, way back 1900s. And there's been lots of things that, you know, went through the research. And so when you want to do this same research, it means you have tons of things to go through. And that makes it very difficult, okay? So imagine in the years when there were no internet, most people go to the library, get tons of papers or books, flip through them for months and even years just to look for a certain information, just one information, okay? So even now that we have internet, it's still quite, you know, difficult, but it is an important part of your research life. Why? Because it summarizes the current knowledge. You should take note of this. It summarizes the current knowledge of the topic that you are trying to research, okay? Then it also gives you an overview of the trend in the field. So most students will approach a professor and say, oh, professor, I want to do this research because I read it on maybe some social media saying something and it looks interesting, okay? But if you don't know the real pattern of the research, what has been done, for instance, those in communication, we are now getting closer to 6G, right? People have done 3G, 4G, 5G, and then going to 6G. So if you are in this field and you want to succeed in this field or you want to publish a good paper, you should know what has been done and what is going on. How are researchers talking about this 6G thing? Okay. Then finally, you will be able to figure out some gaps because, of course, we call it research. So that means if you do your work well, you may, one, add to knowledge, okay? That's, you may add to what has been known over the years, or you may fill in the gaps, okay? So people have done research over and over and there are some mistakes in their research over the years. So what you do is, the smart thing to do is that when you spot these gaps, you project these gaps and tell people that, oh, I found that this is an interesting thing that people have done, but then there's still some gap and I am going to fill this gap with this so-so and so ideas. And that will make you a very good researcher, or that will make your research life easy, okay? Or be able to publish in a good journal as a requirement for most students to graduate. So once you find these gaps, then that means you'll be able to, you know, use these ideas that you have read in this literature, okay, to come up with an argument. Remember, you just saying you found a gap is not enough. You need to build your argument. Your argument will come from several things that you have read from the literature. Okay, so this is just the basic thing about literature review. Now, well, as we have realized these three or four things, then let's jump into the steps that most people agree okay, to use when you are about to do literature research. So I named it the fundamentals of doing literature research, okay? So here, it sounds, you know, trivial, right? Because of course, everyone knows if you want to do your research, you should choose a topic, right? But I must tell you, a lot of students are still struggling with finding a topic. Why? Because they do not know their target audience, okay? Now, what does it mean to have a target audience for your topic? So for instance, me, I am in brain connectivity, okay? I do fMRI and all things that concerns the brain, right? Now, if I want to do a research about addiction, now I should know the kind of researchers that are going to be interested in my research, okay? So not everyone is going to be interested, but you should spot those people who will read your paper, who will read your article, or who will be interested in knowing more about what you are doing. So if you know this, if you know that this group of people are the people going to listen, or are the people going to, you know, ask for more from what I'm doing, then it will give you a general overview of what kind of research you are going to do, or whether you should continue the research. Because remember that if you don't do this, then that means you may not know whether these things that you are talking about has already been done. And that's, I must say, it's a very hurtful thing. So you don't do any of these inquiries and then you jump into the research, you pick any topic and then you start going, and then you get to your second year of your PhD or master's, and then you realize that, oh, it's no more a trend. It's something that is no more needed. You know, it's not needed to be researched on. Then it means you have wasted most of your time doing or pursuing this kind of research. So it's important to know who will read your paper or who will be interested in your paper, and then the topic. Now, the next thing that you are supposed to do is that you need to do your search. Now, I must also emphasize that this part of the fundamentals or the steps is one of the important, you know, steps in all the things that we are going to talk about. Because like I have mentioned earlier, if your field is old, okay, then that means there are a lot of things that, you know, have been done over the years. And so you need to search relevant literature, or you need to search relevant articles that speaks directly to what you are searching for. Okay, so that will bring you to, do you know any database that hold these kinds of articles? And if you know this database, how do you search them? How do you search the articles in these databases? Do you know of any software that can help you to look for these articles that you're looking for? If you know them, then how do you do it? Okay, so this topic, we shall come back to it in the practical section, because this is our main part in the practical section, how to optimize your search when you find a database or you find a website that holds the literature that you are looking for. So the final thing is that take notes while reading and choose the type of review. You know, when you look at this topic, you may say, oh, but everyone knows this. Everyone knows if you are reading, you should take notes. But I can tell you that even happens to me, you know, because we want to, you know, quickly find a way to publish a paper. We just take some few articles, read them, you know, glance through, and then think that we have enough knowledge about what the topic we are searching for. And then we jump straight into the review. And this is a very dangerous thing to do. It happens to me all the time. So what happens is that whilst you are reading, you underline certain things, but you don't take notes, right? And then you begin your research, or you begin your argument, you begin writing your text. Then you realize that, no, there is still some information that you don't know. Now you go back to that same article that you were reading previously and realize that there are some sentences that you didn't read. And I bet you that those sentences that you didn't read may contain salient information that would have helped you to build up a very good argument. Okay, so you do not have to rush in reading a paper. If you are reading a paper, you should have a very critical thinking, because someone took time to write this article, and there may be something that he or she said in that article that may help you to fill in the gap or to add knowledge. So what you should do is that you take notes. So how do you do it? The next slides, following slides, will tell us how to do it. Now, first, to choose a topic or and an audience, at least it must be interesting to you, okay? Most students fall in the trap that because they are being pressured to publish a paper, they pick any topic at all, and then they start investigating. This is a very dangerous thing, because as you go, remember, your research or your student's life is time bound. So that means if you pick a topic that you are not interested in, but just because you think you can do it, but you are not interested in it, when you go ahead, you meet problems. And once you are not interested in this, you may not be willing to overcome those challenges that you meet. Anyone who has interest in something, when the person meets a challenge, the person will find a way to overcome that challenge. But if it is not interesting to you, you'll fall into a very deep hole. And time will be, you know, compiling, and then you get to your third year, and then, you know, it becomes frustrating. So first, it should be interesting to you. Then the next thing is that it should be an important aspect of the field. This is important because you shouldn't take any topic at all. If you, for instance, last time I was discussing with someone, the person said, okay, I want to do CSG. Then later on, if you find out that you are doing 3G, ask yourself, someone doing CSG now and someone doing 3G, who will be able to publish in a very good journal? Or if you are doing a research in 6G or 3G, then that means it must be an important gap that you are filling in 3G. Otherwise, it is not an important aspect of the field in the current time that you are doing your research. So here I said readers will be interested in the review, because if they read your paper, they will know that you are up to date. And they will know that this is important to the field, not something trivial that they can find anywhere. Then the next thing is that it should be a well-defined issue. Why am I saying this? A well-defined issue is that you have so many problems, okay, in a field, but not all the problems are clearly defined. Not all the problems are stated clearly for you to know how to approach it. So let me give you an example. In my field, we have issues concerning people moving their head too much in the scanner when you are scanning them. Now, it is difficult to solve this problem because once the person is in the scanner, you can't do anything. You can only tell the person to stay calm and not to move the head. But how about if we want to find a way to solve this problem without even an effort of the person in the scanner. This issue has been defined clearly, okay? Clearly, so we know the problem, we know what the problem is. So if you are going to solve it, you know exactly what you are going to solve. So if you meet a problem later on in your research, you will find a way to overcome it. But if it's not well defined, you'll just be moving, you know, there are a lot of publications out there, you'll be reading them, you know, and you may not be able to grab actually what the problem is. So you write a proposal to your professor and your professor doesn't know actually what you want to solve. So it should be a well-defined issue in the field of that research. Now, let's go to the next thing, how to do your search. So we know first you have to find your topic and then audience. Now the next thing is how to search, okay? So first of all, you should know the terms that you are looking for in your research. So the terms are important, and how to arrange those terms or those things that you are using to do your search, how to arrange them is important, because then if you publish a paper, then someone can use your same step, okay, to do the same thing that you have done. You know that sometimes when you read a paper, you want to replicate the paper, but you cannot replicate the paper. This is because what has been done in that paper were not clearly stated. How they did the search, how they did all those things were not clearly stated. So you cannot replicate the paper. So for you to be successful, you should be able to keep track of all the items that you have so that someone can pick it up straight and then replicate what you have done. The next thing is, you should keep a list of papers, okay, whose PDF you cannot access directly. So there are a lot of software, okay? For me, I use Mendeley. Now, what Mendeley does is that there are some papers that you cannot get their PDF directly, but it keeps that paper in a database for you, a mini database for you, okay? So even if you cannot have access to that paper immediately, later on, you'll be able to find this topic or this item and then research it to find out whether you can get the actual paper. Otherwise, you can just read it online. The next thing is that, yes, so you use some softwares, like I've mentioned, Mendeley, and then some other ones that many people use, but my favorite is Mendeley because it is easy for me to use. In that way, you can keep the list of papers that you have. You can keep the list of papers that are having PDF and those that are not having PDFs, okay? So if you want to begin your research life, all these things should be something that you should know. If you don't know it, it's going to be very difficult for you to have a paper published as soon as possible. The next is that when you are doing a review, you should know which papers that are relevant or which articles that are relevant and those that are not relevant. So you should state your exclusion criteria clearly. So for instance, if I'm doing a literature review, I will say, for in my field, for instance, we want articles that have two groups. So one is patients and one is control, that is those who are not sick. So if I take this article and I read it and I find out that they don't have these two group of people, I'll exclude them. So when you define your exclusion criteria before you begin your search, that makes life easy for you. It makes life easy for you because then you wouldn't have to go back and forth in in doing the search in the database. So immediately you know which papers are relevant for your research and which papers are not relevant for your research. Now, the next and final thing is that so you want to do your review, you have searched the paper, you have exclusion criteria, you have inclusion criteria, but you should also look for other reviews that have been done. If you remember, when I began, I showed you a chart that we should do review of reviews. So to make your life easy, first, find out other reviews, what they have done. So if you look at those reviews, what they have done, then probably it's going to guide you, you know, on your own journey. Because it's easier for you to have a direction than to just do try and error. So for me, what I do is that whilst I do this exclusion criteria and inclusion and all that, I try as much as possible to find reviews that have been done that is relevant to my field. I look at them, I look at how they did it, what kind of search keywords they used and all that. I go through all of them and then I add their knowledge to mine and then proceed to my own research. So these steps are not actually the full set of lists that you should know. But I think that these are most important things for you to have in during the search of your articles. Other things may come, but I think these are the basic things that you need when you are doing your search. Now, the question is, what about if what you are doing, someone has already done it? When you meet these kind of problems, do not be afraid, because then you will have a lot of things to talk about, right? So you have to read all these papers, find out how they approach the problem, find out their limitation, and then what kind of conclusion did they come up with? So if you know all these three things, the approach, the limitations, and then the conclusions, then you can boldly find out other angles of this problem. So you find other angles of this problem. So someone said A, B, C, D, which is relevant, but your argument is that you can also do E, F, G, H, and it will work, and perhaps it will work better. So that even add more flesh to your argument in your discussion. And also, it doesn't spoil anything to add more knowledge to what has already been done, because this is a scientific field. A scientific field, we need more knowledge to be added. We don't want to get stuck in a loop where the knowledge is only, it becomes archaic and we don't know what new thing to do. So even though someone has done it, you can also add a piece of it and then to add more knowledge to what has been done. So do not be afraid if you find out that someone has already done what you are doing. But be careful to know that if someone has done what you are thinking about, you should be careful to know whether what the person has done has covered everything. So previously we discussed that find out the gaps. So your smartness will be whether to find the gaps in what the person has done or not. But do not force the gap to be there, because most people, out of frustration, they would like to push some gaps. They would like to say, oh, we find that the person used p-value of 0.05, but we know if we use p-value of 0.01, gap to be there. But just find out whether what thing can you add to what has already been done. Okay, so with all this thing, how do we now do the search? Now, someone said you should take notes, and if it becomes a trivial thing to you in the presentation, do not be alarmed, because we have this problem, you and I. So you read the paper and then you think you know everything, unless maybe you have a brain like Einstein. If you have a brain like Einstein, then that's okay. But if you have a brain like me, you should be able to put them down. So first of all, if you use quotation mark, okay, that is very important, because you want to, we want to quote verbatim of what the person has done. But then as you go on, do not be lazy. Try to reformulate what the person has done. Why? Because many students fall into this trap where they realize that they quoted something directly from what they read. Then plagiarism comes in, similarity comes in. But if you read wide enough, you will know how to combine words to reformulate what has been or what you have already quoted. That doesn't mean you are stealing the person's words, but you are just saying what he's saying in another way. And then final thing about taking notes is about references. Most people do not consider the references whilst doing the literature search. After they have done everything, then now they go back to doing reference. People have spent months just organizing references. But today we have software that you can use to do your references. So whilst you are reading, you should take note of these references. Best you should even put them in an Excel, all those references in Excel. That will help you to what? To really show the readers that this is what someone has done. I fell into this trouble before where I quoted something and then I placed a reference beside it, but this reference was not actually what I was referring to. So the reviewer then came and replied and said to me that I should check whether actually this is what the person said. That means the reviewer has already read that paper and knows that what I'm saying is not actually what is inside that paper. So it is important for you to note the references when you are taking the notes. So these three things, okay, searching, looking for a topic and then the topic audience, and then searching and then taking the notes while we read it, is the three most important thing that almost everyone agrees on when you are doing your literature search or you are doing your review. So at this point, we know all these things, but then we also have to find out all these things is just a theory. How can we apply them? How can we apply them? So we have several websites that we can visit for this search. There are more than 100 databases or search engines that can help you to do academic searching. But three of them is my favorite, so I'm going to focus on these three for us to know how to do the search, how to optimize our search. But at this moment, I'll pause a little bit and then ask for some questions, anyone who has some questions, before I move on to the practical section. So these are my three favorite search engines or databases that I use in my field. It helps me a lot to organize my literature. So at this point, I'll pause a little bit and then ask for some questions, and then we'll move on straight to the practical section. Thank you.
Okay, so please, if you have any question for Doc, kindly raise your hand using the raise hand button to just raise your hand and I'll call you, then you ask your question. Thank you.
anyone, because we are going to dive into.
Three people have raised their hands. Okay, so first person I see on my screen, Wafaminta. Kindly unmute yourself and ask your question, please.
All right, thank you very much, Miss Linda. Thank you very much, Doc, for a very nice and wonderful presentation. Doc, I would like to inquire, in a situation whereby you are in a research group with specific research assignment, when you are not allowed to pick topics on your own, as in you are brought in, usually happens to master students and then doctorate. So you have a specific research topic you are working on. How do you channel that of yours, as in talking about your specific interest in a particular field, to what you have been assigned to do by your supervisor? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Wafaminta. I must say that this is a general case for most students, like you said. One thing that I must say here is, you know, before you entered the lab might have had some project in mind, okay? So then if they give this topic to you to do the research, then the general understanding is that they might have done all these things we have talked about. They might have done all the literature search. They might have done all the, you know, the checks and balances to find out whether it's a relevant topic to do. So then when they give it to you, you know, there is no problem. But there are cases where you realize that the topic given to you, whilst reading, you realize that they are no more relevant or they are not within the feasible time for you to, you know, to complete, looking at the number of years you have. So then you should be able to redo all the steps that we have talked about. Then you can present this as a literature review to your professor, or proving to your professor, or highlighting to your professor that, well, this topic you have given to me is good. But along the way, as I read, I realized that these are some of the challenges, okay? And so would it be interesting if we switch to this, you know? So when you talk to your professor that way, then your professor know you have done a thorough, you know, investigation regarding the relevancy of the topic given to you. So most students will just, you know, go to the professor and tell the professor, oh, this topic you've given to me, you know, I'm not really interested. No one will buy that, because the professor spent a lot of time in, you know, carving out this topic. So to tell the professor that this topic, you want to change this topic, then you should be able to do this literature review we are talking about. Then it should be a review spotting some of the gaps in the research, or spotting whether it's relevant within this time or whether it's feasible within the time allocated for you to do it or not. Then you can have an educated, you know, conversation with your professor, and that will solve the issue. Apart from that, I don't see any way for you, you know, as a student to abandon the topic, you know, totally from a professor. I know when I came to this school, I also have a topic in mind, but eventually I had to abandon my topic, because my professor proved to me that it is good, but not really, you know, trending or relevant to get a good publication. So I understood. They showed me the evidence, and so I had to leave it and then pick a topic that we agreed on. I hope I've answered you, you know, clearly, Kofaminta.
Sure. Thank you very much, Doc. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you, Kofaminta. Can you please lower your hand? Okay, thank you very much, sir. Okay, so I saw Mr. Gerald. Your hand was up a while ago, but it's down now. Do you still want to ask a question?
Yes, I do.
Okay, please, you have the floor. Thanks.
All right. Thanks, Doc, for this wonderful enlightenment. I would like to know, is there any criteria that you can use to ascertain the quality of a paper?
Okay. All right. Is that that's all? That's the end of the question.
That's just it.
So short. All right. All right. This is a tricky question you've asked. Whether to know whether the topic, there is a criteria to know whether the topic is relevant. Well, the first thing that you should know is that when you are doing your literature research along the years, you will see the trend of what has been talked about in that topic, okay? So then you come to a recent time, then you realize that this topic was talked over 20 years ago. If you have a topic that has been stopped or that is no more an interest 20 years ago, then the question you should ask is that, is it really important for me? Because remember, if you write an article and then you send it to a publisher, the reviewers are also current. They would like to know whether it's a current thing that is going on. Otherwise, they will say it is not, you know, trending. Okay. Now, that's being said, it is not that the topic, because it was stopped 10 years ago or 20 years ago, it is no more valid. But then there is no way, you know, apart from the years that people are talking about it. So most professors will tell you, try to find this topic within 10 years. 10 years gap. So if it is within 10 years, then we know that this topic is actually a trending one and it's actually a relevant one to the year that you are doing your research. If you go and take a topic that is about 20 or 30 years ago, then what are you trying to prove? Maybe you want to say that you saw something interesting that has been missed for this 30 years and you have found it and you are bringing it to light, and that one is acceptable. But apart from that, you should know that is the year, to me, is the year of that topic, the year that the topic has been discussed and all researchers are talking about it. That makes it very relevant to the research that you are doing. Apart from that, I don't see any way. Other people may have an idea, but apart from that, I don't see any criteria, because you will never know the importance of the paper until you read it, right? If you don't read the paper to know, you know, you don't see the trend of things that are going on in that paper, then you never know how important it is. So you should be able to read all and then find out whether still people are talking about it. Apart from that, I'm afraid it is going to be very difficult for you to, you know, have a relevant or a very good journal to publish your paper in.
Hello. All right, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Gerald. Thank you. Mr. Martins, please, before I call you, hold on, sir, hold on. Please, I would like us to recognize the presence of Professor Ninshie. He just joined us. He just joined us. We are welcome, Professor. You are welcome. Okay, so now we go on to, so Mr. Martin, your hand was up. Can you please ask your question?
Yeah. Please, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, please, I just wanted to add to what Dr. Kluger is talking about. One guy just asked a question concerning the quality of the paper. Most at times you may have a good write-up, but you should first look at the scope of the journal that you want to send. Sometimes if it's not within the scope, you may get dex rejection. And I think it's also one factor. And again, as doctor said, a paper which is currently trending, like issues that are currently trending, you are supposed to dive into those things. And that is what those journals are looking for, those top journals or SSCI journals are looking for. If you begin to do maybe a previous work that has been done for about over 20 years or 10 years ago, it is hard to get it published. So you should just look at what is happening. Maybe, for example, about the climate change situation, about what is happening, the G20 summit. You look at the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, and how to make use the internet to also the Wi-Fi system. You see everything, the financial and technologies, those kind of things are the things that are trending now, and you should channel your ideas and your things, your plans to those side, and you could get a quality paper. The write-up is also very important. As doctor has been saying, the write-up, your introduction and everything is also very, very important. And you have to also get someone to guide you to read through before you submit to adapt to the journal. Thank you. This is what I just wanted to add to what doctor said.
Thank you very much, Martins. It's very important, like you said. Yes, so, you know, you should know your way around your research. Do not immediately jump into the research. You should do a lot of, you know, background, you know, investigation before you jump into it, so that you don't waste your time chasing something, submitting the paper over and over, and then eventually you realize that you have wasted enough time. Yeah, thank you. Anyone else, so that we can jump into the practical section?
Any more questions, please, so that we move on? Okay, Edward, please, you just posted in the chat room that you have a question. Kindly unmute yourself and ask your question. Your question, Edward.
Hello, good evening. Please, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Hello, Doug.
Hello.
I want you to I want to use myself as example, because when I was doing my master's degree, and you know, I went to my professor and we wanted to discuss if the professor will give us a topic so that we can research in. Because as we know, some of us, we just switch. Like what we did in our bachelor degree, different from the master's. So like, hello, please, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yes, okay, please, so, you're not speaking. Kindly mute yourself so that Edward can ask his question. Thanks.
So it's like we went to our professor and our professor told us to go and search for our own. So we also, like, we were two. So we read and we find a topic that we were interested in. But at the end of the day, when we were facing some challenges, like we are finding it difficult for, let's say, our predecessors to help us. Because if you contact someone, the person will tell you, I'm not into this, I'm not into that. And it was a big challenge to ask. So in this kind of, although you have interest in some specific topic, but you don't know, maybe when you have any issue, you find it difficult for someone to help you in the long run. So what advice can you give to us? Like, okay. All right. If you find yourself in such a situation.
Okay. Thank you very much for this this question. I know this is an important question that many people have also faced. Yes, professor asks you to get your own research topic, and then you got your own research topic, but then this research topic seemed to be an island, right? Now, there is a kind of trade-off, okay? There is a kind of trade-off because if you pick a topic that everyone knows, then the probability that that topic would not be trending is high, okay? Or the probability that that topic may not be innovative, that's what I want to say, may not be innovative enough is high. But then if you pick a topic that is really kind of rare, the innovation in it is almost, is, you know, kind of 100% or 95%. But the challenge you face is you may not have anyone to help you because nobody knows it. Even your professor might not have any knowledge about it. So the advice I will give is that when you face these kinds of challenges, you should be able to do the literature research again. Why am I saying this? You then limit your search in a short time, like let's say 5 years. Then you get a lot of papers that might be closer, okay? We will come to that in the practical section, but you get researchers or you get papers or articles that are closer to what you are doing. Then you formulate your own ideas from it. They might not be perfect. You formulate your own ideas from it. And then you push for a group discussion. Why am I saying this? Because this helped me a lot. You get your own concepts from all the things that you have read. You get your own understanding of it. And then you have a literature review, right? You send this literature review, a full literature review to relevant people to read. Now these people will read this review because review is a story. So they will read this. Then you call for a group meeting. Then you tell them that after everything that I've read, this is what I've gotten. So what do they think about? They may not have 100% idea, but they will tell you, well, when I read the paper, this is what I got. You put them down. This one said, I got A. This one said, I got B. This one said, I got C. You put all of them together and then you chain them together and then form your arguments. This is the only way you can do it because most students, I must tell you, want to work as a lone ranger, but it will kill you. In a research field, you don't do things by yourself, okay? So if you are finding the problem and then you do all your literature research, you write down your review and you send to relevant people, I'm sure you are going to get some idea from it. And to me, that's the only way you can survive in this situation where you have a topic where nobody seems to know anything about. I hope I've answered you well. Maybe there may be other things, but I think this is the only way you can go. Try to write a review. Give this review to people to read. Then call for a meeting. Tell them your idea after reading and then ask, solicit for what they have, you know, after reading the review that you've given to them. And that is your way to go. Do not be afraid to contact researchers. Most students are afraid to contact researchers. Don't be afraid. Just contact them, you know, let them know this is your challenge. You give them what they want, they read, and then they tell you what they know about what you've given to them. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Doc. Eddie, I hope you've been answered. So, Doc, there is a question for you in the chat group. The person is Mesfin. He's asking, hello, Doc. For undergraduate thesis, what should be the minimum of time to dedicate for literature review, or how many papers should be read before diving into the thesis project?
Yeah, the simplest answer that I will give okay, is that as much as you can, as much as you can, because you will never know. And I think our next section, which is the how to optimize searching, is going to help you, because when I say as much as you can, of course you cannot download about 1,000 papers and think that you read all these 1,000 papers before you write your review. No, that's not a very good way to go. If you know how to do your search well, you will narrow your search to relevant articles, and that will limit your time. That will also cut down your time or optimize your time. So do not be alarmed. First, remember, it is as much as you can, but you should know how to search your papers. You should know how to search your papers. So as for the time, there is no one, you know, there is no rule for the time, but it depends on how you do your search for your papers and all that. But remember, you will never know which paper contains the answer that you need. So you have to read everything. So when we get to the searching part, you will really appreciate what I'm talking about. It will help you to cut down your search a lot. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Doc. Please hold on with, I know a lot of people have a lot of questions because this is an interesting and significant topic. But Doc wants to move on to the second section, after which maybe you can ask more of your questions because we are time bound in as much as we really want to take this program far. So please hold on with your questions for now. When Doc is done with the second section, then you make your questions flow before Professor Nishe takes over. Thank you. So Doc, please continue.
Okay. So thank you for all your questions. We shall come back to it. So let's go directly to our practical section. So we are going to use three popular search engines or databases for literature. And my favorites are, you know, Web of Science, PubMed, Scopus, and of course, Google Scholar. But as you know, we sometimes find difficult to, you know, get Google working around here. So I think it is best that I introduce you to those ones that you can easily get access to. They are equally very, very, very effective. So I'm going to share my screen. We'll go to hold on a bit. Okay. So can you all see? Can you all see Web of Science? Yes. MC, can you see the Web of Science?
Yes, we can see. Yes, we can see.
All right. Okay. So now we are going to deal with, please, this part you should take a very serious note of this part of the presentation because it's going to be a practical thing. Now, let's begin with Web of Science. So many schools have Web of Science, okay? So Web of Science is normally purchased by the institution. So sometimes when you are outside the campus, it is difficult for you to get access to Web of Science. However, some schools have VPN that you can use, legal VPN that you can use to get access to link to the school. So in Web of Science, this is how the interface looks like. And first thing you should do is that we have something we call select database. So in the select database, what it means is that there are a lot of databases that has been linked to Web of Science. Some schools have their own database ported there. But for us to optimize our search, it is better for us to choose all databases. All databases. Okay. So we also have Scopus. Okay. It looks the interface of Scopus looks like this. You can see search here. And then we have here PubMed. So the first thing that we are going to do is that how to optimize search in Web of Science. Okay, so we choose our all database. Now, the next thing you should do is that how are you going to do the search? Do you have to search it based on topic? Do you have to search it based on the titles of articles or by authors? Why is the author important? Because sometimes a certain author has a lot of articles that is relevant to your research. So you would want to search that particular author's articles. So then you click on author. So you search the articles by the author's name. The most, you can also search by publication name, okay? Maybe journal of something. So you search the papers, all those articles that have been written in that. Or you can search by publication year. So when you search by publication year, just put in the years here. But the popular ones are topics. Why? Because topics will give you a broader view of whatever you want to search in. Then the next thing that you should do is that try to see if you can customize your search years. I have told you in the beginning that the year is important. We want to see if we have relevant and trending articles. So for instance, in my case, I would like to maybe start my search from 2000 to 2020. Now you can see a drop down here. This drop down we have, so here it will tell you what kind of database do you want to search in. So some people would like to limit the database that they want to search in. So, but for the proper purposes of optimizing our search, we'll select everything. Okay. Now, let's go to the basic search. So this is the first thing, basic search. Now in basic search, so for instance, I want to search for epilepsy. Now see, I've wrongly spelled epilepsy, but let's look at when I click on search. When I click on search, it tells me, are you referring to this kind of epilepsy? If you say this kind of epilepsy, then we have 110 results for this kind of epilepsy, but the one you type in, we cannot find. So actually it gives you, so it says, your search found no record. Then here, it tells you, just like in Google, it tells you, do you mean this? If you meant this, then we have about 110 results for you. Now, when you click it, it takes you straight to the articles that you are like, so you can see it's all in the topics, okay? The topic epilepsy. Okay. Now, in this page, you can also limit the search. In this page, you can also limit the search. You can limit the search. So you can see here, we have 110. So what if, and then this gives you the statistics. It means for this epilepsy, in 2020, we have 6 articles. In 2018, we have 11 articles. So this will give you an idea of the trend of what you are looking for.
So meaning that actually the trend of or the importance started around 2018. But then over some years on, it became, you know, less steady, and then it got up again due to maybe some other things, okay? And here you can search for it in various, because remember, if I type epilepsy, it will tell me how many of them are in science and technology, how many of them are in the social sciences, how many of them are in the humanities. So for me, who is in School of Life Science, I will be interested in maybe just this one. That's the first one, okay? And something I can get, you know, a relevant results from what I'm looking for. But if I leave everything like this, it means we will have a lot of data to sift through, which will waste your time, okay? Now, let's go back to search. Okay, and let's look at the various ways you can do your search. Now, so let me increase my search domain so that we can have a feel of how it is. So I'm saying from 1990 to 2020. Now, I click here, add row. Now there is a Boolean function here, Boolean function. Now, what do I mean by Boolean function? Okay, now Boolean function means that you have this, you can actually find your way in adding, and then you can see here, or, and then not, okay. So what does end does? End means I type epilepsy, and then I type here functional network. Okay, now what it means is that I should be able to have a topic that contains epilepsy and then functional network. Now, let's do the search and look at the number of articles we have. So in this search, using the AND function or the AND Boolean function, we have 3,308 articles. Now, let's go back and then use OR. So if I, so remember we have 3,300 and something articles. Now, if I use OR and I click on search, we have about 378,864. That means either you bring me epilepsy or you bring me functional network. So be very attentive with this kind of search parameters and or, okay? So if you use or, that means you will have a lot of articles to deal with. Okay. Now let's go back and see something else. Now, when I go to not, so I said epilepsy, but not functional network. And I click on search. I have 193. So 193,000 compared to when I did epilepsy and functional network. Please get this thing straight. So it means that when you put and between those two words, it limits your search to only those ones. Now, when you put or, it expands the search. When you put not, it eliminates all those words that you are saying it should eliminate, plus those in the search engine. So you realize that the number here has increased compared to when I use and. All right. So and is the kind of Boolean function. Okay. Let me take this opportunity to explain to you here. I know most of you did mathematics, so this is not a difficult thing to you. So we have epilepsy, we have functional network. So this actually is this way. If you are looking for and, okay. And should be here. Okay. Now, if I'm looking for or, so I have this, I have that, and I have this. All means you should take A or find B, sorry, or find C. So any of them works, okay? Any of them works. Now let's look for or not. So we have here. So I'm saying A and this is B. So A and not B, okay? A and not B. So that means that I should only take all this part, only this part, okay? And then exclude this part. So that's what I mean by Boolean function. So I'm looking for epilepsy and functional network, or epilepsy or functional network. And then epilepsy, but not functional network. You should get this search very important in your sleeve, or under your sleeve, because it will help you to limit your search, the number of papers you are going to get, and then help you to limit the time you spend in reading, just like someone asked me. Okay, now let's go back to the page. Now, there are other things also called wildcard. And these wildcards are, it looks like it is the Boolean function, but also helps you to do the search well. So how does it do that? So I am looking for epilepsy, okay? I'm looking for epilepsy. Then I found the epilepsy, but I write something like this. Okay, let me reset. So I write something like this. Hydroxy, then I put a star in front of it. What does it mean? It means that find anything that begins with this hydroxy and then add the other ones. So you can see when we do the search, you can see here, hydroxyapatite. And then here has hydroxyl, and then here has hydroxyvitamin. So it means find all those words that begins with hydroxy. find all those words that begins with hydroxy. So for instance, in my search, okay, I want to find a word that begins with, so I say, I write here, something that begins with, functions, okay? Then I click on okay. You will have words, okay, that will give you things that has function in it, okay? When you go deep, deep down, you'll find those words that have functioning. It will be functional network or functional something, something that is relating to function. Let's go to the next wildcard. So this is asterisk wildcard. Now we have another wildcard. We like the question mark sign. Okay, the question mark sign. So the question mark sign here means that if I type something like, so I have this, and then OBLAST, okay? It means that find all those words that contain something like this, okay? So when I click, okay, immediately finds all those words that have, may it could be ENO something or other things. Okay. Now I'm told I have 9 minutes more, so I'll wrap it up quickly. Now let's go to another important one. Okay. The dollar sign. The dollar sign. What does the dollar sign do? So if I have something like 8, okay, that means it could be 80, 80th, 18th, or something that will proceed with this T. So anything that comes before this one will be captured. So that's how you do your search. Now, let's go to another one, okay? Here, we can also do a search, okay, by using whole words. So I put here in the bracket, I say, I'm looking for addiction and cocaine. Okay, so this is what it does. So it will find words that has addiction and then cocaine in it, okay? So in this way, you don't have to search everything. So from here, you can limit your search. You can limit your search from here and then eventually. So for instance, if I click here, okay, and I click on refine. See, the number has changed, okay? Or I go to, here, okay? And then I said, refine my search. So you can see we only have 30 out of the 1,000 and something researches that we have looked for. We have only 30 now. So the one asking me how much time for you to spend in researching, this is your way to go. If you do it right, you may not have to spend a lot of time doing your search. Okay, it's getting closer to time. So I think this is about all for Web of Science. Now, let me quickly go to Scopus, this is important for you. So in Scopus 2, for instance, I can type, I can put in quotations, okay, addiction, okay, and then and put this one in quotes and say behavior or something, maybe pain. And then here too, it says article, which how to search. So here I want to search everything from the title, abstract, and then keywords. So I click on search. Okay, so here, this is what it does. Please pay attention to this one. I'll show you something that is really nice. So assuming I've finished my search, everything here is what I want. So what I need to do is just click on this one, click on this, or maybe just view, I can view the abstract. Okay, I can view the abstract and find out, okay, we have behavior here, we have addiction here. So that is good. Then you go to this one, export to CSV file. So export to CSV file, you can select any of these things, okay, and then click on export. Now, when you click on export, and then you have, okay, let me show you. So I just want to show you how important Scopus is and how easily it is for you to use. So you can see it has actually arranged it into authors, title, year, blah, 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 blah. You know, I'm in a hurry. So what will happen is that you get author's name here, you get a title here, you get a year here, you get, so you don't need to do that by yourself, okay? So once you do that, once you do the selection, okay.
You can see the Excel though.
You can see the Excel. Oh. Can you see?
Please open
it. Can you see it now?
Yes, please open it.
Okay, so can you see the Excel now?
No,
not yet. It seems you've not opened it.
Okay, I've not opened it. Oh my.
You cannot share it to the screen.
Okay.
Yeah, it has now.
Okay. So you can see here, we have authors, title, year, source, link, abstract, blah, 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 right? So this is important. Actually, if you take your time to do it, you get everything here. But then you don't need to write it by yourself. So what Scopus does is it arranges these things for you for future reference. Okay. Now let me quickly go back to the Scopus. All right. So this is how it is. And then you have a download here. So all the papers I've selected, I can click on download. Okay. Then blah blah to tell you extension. You know, you have to put in it. Then it will download the PDF for you directly. Okay, so this is how it is. So, this is the end of the practical section. Sorry. And so, I know I've given much attention to Web of Science and then Scopus, but for PubMed, maybe later, you guys can contact me and then I can show you how to do it. So now, because of time, I will go straight to the rest of the PPT so that the next professor will come and then do his presentation.
Could you please share with us your WeChat ID? Your WeChat ID.
Yeah. They will send, the MC will send it around for you guys to see. Okay.
Okay.
So don't worry. Now, so the final thing that I would like to say is that, which will help you on your way to your thesis or your dissertation, is every week or two, search for an article on a topic. This will help you to build your review in a few years. So first you download and put them into various folders. Actually, I use Mendeley, and Mendeley helps me a lot. So you can see here, it has arranged them in, I have here OCD, I have here internet gaming, blah, blah, blah. So when you open it, you have all the articles that are relating to internet gaming. So then you don't need to do anything by yourself. You know, this is the modern world. You don't need to do everything by yourself, and it will help you to cut down your time, okay? The next thing is make a spreadsheet. So this is the spreadsheet that I showed you earlier. So I have here the number of papers, the authors, the title, the year, the journal. The level is important because then you will know how important that paper is. And then the contribution. So this contribution, you need to write it by yourself. And then you write maybe some weaknesses of the paper. That will help you to build up your argument in future. So for all these things that you need to do, you need to be careful with how you choose your topic, how you do your searching, and how you take down your notes or how you organize your literature. So this is the end of this presentation. I hope you have learned something, and I hope that in future we can meet and then talk more. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. This has been very informative. So without wasting much time, I would like to call on Professor Nishia to take over. But before that, please be aware that details of this practical session will be held maybe sometime later in January. It will be a detailed workshop. So stay tuned for the time and the date. Okay, so Professor Nishia, please, you are welcome. So kindly take over, sir.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Sir.
Cool.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes. Okay, let me share my slide. Okay. Is there first a slide? Shall we start?
Yes, please.
Okay. This is a really great honor to share the knowledge about the pipeline of research with yours. I just know both of students in China, also in Ghana, to join into this meeting. So at tonight, so it's quite a surprise to me. Okay, maybe first I will give a self introduction. So my name is Ning Xie, so you can call me Ning. I got my doctor degree in before coming to the UESTC in Chengdu, China. I was in Shanghai, Tongji University, and also we have several points. So let's skip the introduction. And then we basically in the computer science. So our research interest includes computer graphics, human-computer interaction, also machine learning, and its application specifically to the game. Also animation, and someone like a video special effect, such as in the movie industry. So also our work is supported by several fundings. Okay, let's move to the main topic of today's slide. So the first thing is quite interesting and also important. Why choose research? So actually, are we students or the researchers, we need to consider this one carefully. So the first thing is, I would like to mention that scientific research is not equivalent to do some research and develop the application. So this is quite different from both of them. So let's make a clarification. The aim of scientific research is to explore the new knowledge. And also we try to create some new technology. But the aim of the development usually is to use the known knowledge and make something useful for our daily life. Okay, and then we know the scientific research, the point is to extend human knowledge, not to make some product directly. So we can see that no scientific research, no technology improvement. This is, we need to clarify our brain first. So comparing with the previous professor speaker, and my slide is a little bit higher level than the detail of how to use some tools to do research, or how to do the survey of your research area. But I give some lines that why, what's the purpose, also how to communicate with maybe the supervisor. So I'm not that young, but I'm still young supervisor to the student. So for the students, I guess maybe I can share my experience with you. Okay, the next point we need to clarify is why to write paper. Okay, so some of you may say, if I would like to go to the degree, the school or the university said I need to write down the dessert, and then they can give us the degree. Or someone may say, okay, my supervisor said, blah, blah, journal is quite good. We have to write it. And maybe some of you may not know what is the truth behind. Actually, for the scientific research, the topic we focus on today is to write the paper. We would like to share or tell our work to the peers. And then that's the reason why for the top conference or the journals, we need to cross through the peer review, and then your work can become into a scientific literature. So this is the reason why we would like to write the paper. So for the fundamental research, or we can say that the scientific research usually is quite far from the practical application, as I mentioned last slide. Also, there may some works can implement it as a real application in our daily life. For example, nowadays it's quite popular, the face recognition. And then some of the, for example, the traffic station, also the subway station, and also in front of the gate of our school, we use the face recognition. That's quite some of a unique example that we can directly use a peered scientific research to our daily life. Okay, if let's join down the roadmap of the research,
is from the front, that's a frontier research, and then we may make that technology mutual at our laboratory, or maybe some is can turn or transfer into the industry. But to the industry guys, that's still new technology. If we plan to apply those technology into some products in the industry, we still need to take more time. So here are quite huge gap between the frontier research output until the mutual technology in the industry. For example, some functions in the app in your cell phone, okay? Let's move to the other question. Is it easy to write paper? Okay, some guy maybe say, well, write paper is easy. It's just a descript of your work once you have got a good result. Okay, the point is, how can we got good result? No good result research to support us to write those papers. This is the key behind. So we have to say the paper is due, but not just write down something. Okay, so let's clarify or contextualize that things. Only 10% time cost to write down your paper. For example, when you do your paper, do the experiment, and then a study on the theoretical part, you may take over 90% time. So this is the point we need to clarify. Okay, let's move to some valuable or useful structural method. How to do the research? Well, it's a TPIC, or you can also call it topic. So the first thing is topic. As the previous speaker said, okay, my research is about blah, blah, blah. And we focus on, what's that just now? The functional something. And then this is your topic. What's the real scientific problem behind? This is you need to mining out it. And then when you point a fix on that problem, you have to propose your own idea and try more concrete work, try your heart to do it. For us in computer science, usually we do both sides, the theoretical analysis, mathematical proving, and the other part is to run some experiment. In the case, usually we run the toy data set. Also, we have to do some demos. It's somehow practical. And then to say our idea or our paper work is useful. And then the next step is to try to start to write your paper for the paper writing and then submit it. Wait for the feedback of the reviewers, okay? So for the next slide, so the main point is let's explain what is the pipeline or the structural method behind. Let's separate them into many four parts. So the first one is how to focus on your topic. Well, we just gave the example in our research area, computer science. We're including AI, artificial intelligence, also computer graphics, database, hardware, multimedia network, software engineering, or theoretical computer science, blah, blah. And then when we focus on the detail, what one we would like to study more, for example, in AI, there are some automated reasoning, computer vision, knowledge engineering, knowledge representation, machine learning, multi-agent system, natural language processing, pattern recognition, planning, and so on. And what's that yours? So how to get your own topic? This is quite important. So the first thing, if you are lucky, usually your supervisor will give you one. Suppose your supervisor knows a lot in this area. So there is another point I need to clarify. Some many of my students usually discuss with me, say, okay, professor, this topic is not good. I don't want to do this one. But usually I just let them to take more time, maybe 2 or 3 weeks to do the survey of the paper's literature review, and then to see what's the truth behind. So as we mentioned here, there is no good or bad research area. It really depends on how many time or how many attention pay on to that area and how you work. If you work deeply, you may find any of the research area is valuable to work on. Another thing is, say, for example, we mentioned that deep learning nowadays in computer science is quite hot, right? But that's the case. Sometimes, for example, the deep learning topic now is quite active in a recent maybe 5 years. There are a lot of quite good works there. So that's just a special case. For example, some of the researchers, they are now still working on the theoretic algorithms. This is still valuable, but it's made not that hot. So this is the point we need to remember. Usually the supervisor will determine or give you a topic. You just try to keep peace and study deeply and then to find out the real valuable behind. Okay, and then there will still have some other ways to do the research. For example, you read key papers to this topic and then learn the research roadmap and then the current situation. Okay, this is quite normal. But usually the student, they will ask, where can I got those key papers or important papers? At the beginning, usually, you may ask your supervisor, ask him or her to help you. This is quite a fast way. Also, based on the supervisor's suggested paper, you can find out more. Usually, you can read those the reference list and then to pick up the topics or the papers. The first thing is the title. You may think that the other thing is there are usually have some ranking of the top conference, also the top journal. And you can follow in those things to pick up the papers to read. And the last thing is when you don't understand, you can jump and then turn back several weeks later. So this is the point. When you list, like the last speaker said, for example, the undergraduate student dissertation thesis. So how many paper you have to read, you need to read. Usually our answer is as many as possible. Yes, that's true. But for the undergraduate student, usually in my case, I will suggest a student 10 key papers to read first, and then there are 2 or 3 papers that's very, very important. You may have to re-implement that one. And then later in the experiment, you have to make the comparison with them. Okay, and then for this one, some paper you may not understand at that moment, okay? Just hold on and put it away well, 1 week, 2 weeks, and then turn back. When you read more knowledge on some other papers, you may understand or you may suddenly got the key points there later. For example, my quite excellent student, Joseph, at beginning, he still do not know which topic, but when I read his resume, CV, his research interest is around the gaming, the game technology. So comparing with the research topic in our laboratory, finally we focus on the motion capture. That's quite important for the gaming, because when we play the game, you know the actions, motions. Sometimes that's gaming by made by the artist. But for the modern methodology, usually it's a capture from the real person. So we try to work on this topic and understand the pattern behind what's the meaning of some similar action. For example, those actions are means for wave your hand, note, and wave your hand, for example, like these things. Okay, I'll show you the video. This is just this afternoon. I gave the new devices to Yusuf, and then he tried the devices. And also, it's quite quick. He told me for the just one afternoon, he just linked this new devices to his algorithm together. Okay, quite interesting. So the other, from next slide, I'll show you some detail about how to choose topic. Okay, let's move. The case you, if you have to decide the topic by yourself, we have a method 001, ask someone. It's quite similar to the last speaker said, okay, maybe the fellow student, the older sisters or the brothers in your laboratory, or someone have graduated from this laboratory. And then there are another ways, for example, you can ask top scholars. Those scholars or professors, maybe they visit your own school. Once you may go to the conference, the research conference, you have the chance to communicate with them. But there are several points you should really take care. The first thing is be more polite. This is very important because those top scholars, professors are quite busy. So you have to, how to say, clarify or justify your own attitude. The other thing is, for example, don't be sad if there are no feedback from them, especially when you send email to them. The reason is that some of the top professors or scholars, they may have their own students a lot. So for those students, they have to think over how to give their ideas or topics. For you, the visitors, maybe it's quite a long delay. The other thing is by sending email, the scholars, they may receive over hundreds of emails. Same thing, just the same with yours to ask for the topic. So this is the reason why usually it's the feedback quite late, or maybe there are no feedback at all. There are still some other ways. For example, you can go to the BBS, which one is focused on discussing the research, some mail list. If the students you are in China, nowadays in China, the young, student or young people quite popular, Zhihu. Okay, you can go there to find out the valuable stuff there. Let's introduce the message 002. It's by yourself. Okay, let's link to link together with previous speaker. So if we have to search papers by ourselves, you need to clearly know the top conference are all the journals in your own area, no matter computer science, chemistry, physics, and so on. Okay, there are some quite useful tools we use in the UESTC. For example, the www.myhuiban.com, and then that's the screenshot I show in on the slide. So here you can see they may have some list of the conference or the journals. There are also the submission, notification, and so on. The more important stuff is there. You see the, for example, on the slide, all the codes, those are the rankings. You may understand the rankings and then to pick up which level belong to your own research and you focus on to submit those things. Okay. Another point is important. First of all, it's better to find out the recent year's papers. Usually it's around 2 or 3 to 5 years. That's quite important. You know the recent tense of your research area. Also, when you pick up some key papers, you need to read them carefully. And then at this stage, to getting your own topic, you only need to read abstract is enough. Okay. And then at this stage, you may say, okay, by your own, you may read over hundreds or 200, even 500 papers abstract to understand the tense or the distribution of the topics in your area. This is quite important to you. Okay, let's say, what is the hot topics? Actually, it really depends on your own situation. For example, for the, let's see, this is normal distribution. And then the x-axis is the level of researchers or the scholars. For example, near to the left-hand side, that's the top researchers or the peers. Usually, they do some research really exploration. Otherwise, that's mirror to the other side. That's for the newcomers. Or maybe the most of the, let's say, undergraduate students research. What we need to do is to do some topic or technology carefully. And then you work on those things. But for the senior researchers, usually they may concentrate on the center. That's the hot topics. Well, we can also see in the computer science or the AI, artificial intelligence, usually the research area or the Chinese researchers are in the region of this junior researcher. So this is the current situation in China. Okay, let's continue. Which one is suitable to you? And then it's may, according to your own situation, including your interest. For example, I paste the game screen here because, for example, my student Yosef, he had made a lot of game before coming to China. So we pick up some gaming technology to Yosef, to him. And then the other point is your own knowledge structure. Your academic background is also important. That supports you why you can make success in this area, in this topic. And the other thing is quite useful. Can you got necessary resource? For example, for us, for the gaming, especially for the game AI, usually it's very, very hard to get the data. So you need to decide this topic is suitable for you or not. But nowadays, for example, together, we work on the game AI with a game company in China, Tencent. So we are lucky that we can get data. We work on those data to propose new methods. So this is our situation. So I organize several students. We focus on game AI and then to play on it, okay? Once we finish the topic, let's move to the problem. Here is a specifically focus on the scientific problem. Let's see the detail. we say the scientific problem is the heart of your research. Any of scientific research aims to solve the problem. So once you get good problem, that's you got reached the halfway of your success. No matter one paper, two papers, or several papers. And also the problem is the real start of your research work. So no matter how many papers you read, usually this is important, the problem. Find out your own scientific problem. I always tell my own students, you do not just read hundreds and thousands of papers. Just start to work on your own problem. Find out it. What's the difference? Usually, the independent search, this is the independent search ability. Know how to find out the problem. Okay? Now, we are interested in how to got those things. The first way is also to ask your supervisor. If you got those things, you are lucky. So you not need to, you have to do on this problem as soon as possible, quickly. That's the reason. Otherwise, we say some or many, most of the supervisors will do it by themselves if you are too slow. Because the supervisors know the topics, they know where is the real research problem, scientific problem. This is the most valuable part. And otherwise, many researchers, they may work on the same problem. We have many examples of this. So I gave the topic to my students. I also listed the problem, scientific problem. They are too slow. So maybe half years, maybe quarter. When we read the top conference or journals, we see, okay, there are several papers. They try to solve the same problem. Another thing is to find out by yourself. So you also have to ask your supervisor to help to decide which one is the real scientific problem. I also have some real case to this. So I organized the laboratory meeting twice per week. One, we call it lunch meeting. That's quite quick. For each member, we give usually 5 minutes to quickly go through their main progress per week. So the student, they may list or show us the most valuable things there. At this moment, the student, they may show the idea, the problem to me. So I can help to decide which one is useful. But some of the students, they didn't communicate with me, no matter one semester, maybe half year, maybe 1 year. When some other officers in our department ask them, why you do not communicate with your supervisor? The answer is, okay, I'm doing my research smoothly. Once I got a nice result, I may show them to my supervisor. This is not the moment. My answer is no. From very beginning, when you choose the topic, when you pick the problem, you need to communicate with your supervisor. And then they can justify your correct direction to do it. Also, you know, nowadays a supervisor is not, they are just your friends, not teachers in the old time. So you can easily just friendly to communicate with them. No matter. Also in China, as I know, most of the supervisor, we treat students lunch, maybe dinner, once we have to discuss some valuable research problem. Okay, and then next is find out all the papers to this problem. This is important. and then read those papers given by the supervisors first, and then just read more, searching by your own. There are several points you need to work on. You need to find out the pros and cons. What's the advantage of those papers? What's the shortcomings and limitations of these papers? And then another question is, why have not done well yet of this scientific problem? And also get your own unique work pipeline. This is the start of your work on your own algorithm, for example. Okay? If you are not that lucky in the case, you have to do it by yourself 100%. How to progress? The first thing is to read the top conference over 20 or 30s. And then that should be the leading expert's work. Some important information there. So usually when my student pick up several papers, I usually ask them the question, who are which universities are there? So we need to roughly first to find out the leading experts. This is quite important. The other thing, have those problems by your own interest. For example, to me, during the my doctoral period, my research interest is digital art. So I would like to make my own algorithm to let the machine or the robot to join some Chinese traditional painting by themselves, use algorithm. So this is my doctor topic. So okay, my supervisors say, no problem, just try to use some machine learning technology to serve them. The other thing is to find out or fix the valuable problem. Also, this is quite important, your own knowledge structure. What's your background there? So you have the confidence to, this let you to have the confidence to finish or complete your work. Also, resource data, this is important. The other things we need to focus on is not focus on the huge problem. Just focus on the tiny scientific problem and then do more in detail. This is quite important because most of us are the beginners of research or the scholars. You cannot solve the very huge problem to our human being. Okay, so this is our own position. Just try to focus on the tiny problem and then do our best more and more to solve each scientific problem one by one. This is our mission at current stage. Once you become the leading expert, you can do more. For example, the opening problem or the huge scientific problem. The other thing is to practice the ability to do the research. You may pay more and not on the output itself. That means you need to take your time and your effort to just do it. Do not care more about the output, the experiment result good or not. So this is quite like, I guess maybe the Asian philosophy. Usually we think the result is not that important, but you may know the way how to do the research. This is most important things. Usually in the university, in the school, for the master students, we have 3 years. The key important is we teach students how to do research, even by how to do research by themselves. In the future, we do not would like to turn the students into a, let's say, the experiment operator. You just know how to do the experiment following the operation manual. No, this is not our mission. What we would like to do is to teach students how to be a researcher, how to find out your own topic, how to find out the scientific problem behind, and then how to use your own idea, how to propose that one. Okay, let's move to the third thing, the idea. This is the moment to test your own wisdom. No supervisor can give you lessons to you. Well, if they do so, you are lucky. But most of things have both sides, like the coin, the good and not good, and also the bad. That means if your supervisor give you all the things there, your rule is become into a operator, not a researcher. You have to clarify this point, okay? The other thing is you may have a lot of and lot of ideas. Usually you need to set up a meeting to communicate with your supervisor to let them to decide which one is good, how to make the comparison of those ideas, and then to sort which one you need to work on first. This is quite important. Just communicate with your supervisor. And then how to work on finding out the idea. There are several cases. If they say nobody help you, what we need to do? You have to do it by yourself and then work harder. Work on, is it new idea? This idea is reasonable? And also this one is reachable. That means if you can finish by your own or by your lab mate and put away 1 week or consider if there are some better idea and then try to do it in the next week. If you can answer those questions by yourself and also is approved by your supervisor, just do it as soon as possible. I will give you a real case. That's my PhD supervisor told us. For us, the Asian researchers or the Asian graduate students, from you have the idea, you implement it and then do the experiment, usually until you write down your paper before submitting, you may take at least 3 weeks. You may take this, 3 months to reach the top conference or the top journal. You know those guys in America, in the US, for example, in the top university, MIT, Berkeley, if they have some good idea at this moment, until they write down all of the papers before submitting, they just use maybe 10 days. 10 days. Another one is 3 months. That means if you got the idea, you have to do it as soon as possible. This is usually I tell my students, if you got idea, just do it quickly. Okay, the last part, the concrete work. Once that is your idea need to be supported. For example, you in computer science, our research area, 2 parts are very important. The first one is a theoretical analysis, and the other one is experimental verification. So for the theoretical analysis, the first thing is important, even we are in the computer science, that's a solid mathematics. Learn by yourself first and then try to find out a collaboration with someone. if you cannot serve it by your own. This is also the reason why in my laboratory, I welcome many students majored in mathematics, no matter in undergraduate or the master's degree. So this is the reason in the area of computer science, usually the theoretical analysis, we need a lot of mathematics. The other thing is the experimental verification. This one is not just run experiment as many as possible. The thing is you need to do the elegant design of experiment. Okay, and then later you can just Google or Baidu design of experiment. This is a theoretical research area. Also is to have to learn by yourself. Also, the other thing is together with your lab mate to work on. Okay, the other thing is how to do it, the concrete work. For the theoretical analysis, you need to do it more carefully and no link from each dimension. The other thing is just try to use a simple and efficient tools. Firstly, the tools means many methods in mathematics to us in the machine learning or the geometry on computer graphics. We usually use statistics for the computer graphics. We use a lot of the geometry in 3D. For experimental verification, we also need to do in detail and carefully design. Also, the other thing is important is baseline testing. You need to make the comparison with those benchmarks. Also, the data set is important. You need to make the comparison with others, you also need to apply the data set, run your own algorithm on the same data set used by the other scholars. And the most important thing, I mark them here with the capital, also in red color, we have to make the attention on it. That's your experimental repeatability is very, very important. For example, there is a case in 2014. At that moment, I still in Japan. Okay, some researchers in the Nikken, that's the top academic institute in Japan, not every year, maybe every year, they always have Nobel Prize persons there. So they have one paper on the journal Nature. But the problem is here, their experiment cannot be repeatable. So there were a lot of problems in Japan. At last, the author's supervisor, Yoshiki, is a suicide by himself, just at his office. This is quite serious, very, very serious. You need to take carefully on your experimental repeatment. Also, that have to be the truth. I always double check with the result of my student. I always ask them, your experiment result have to be the truth first. And then second, your experiment need to be repeatable. And then your result can be repeatable by other researchers, no matter in our own university or some others all over the world. And then, necessary analysis and explanation, you need to list them in your own paper. For example, in the discussion section, just before the conclusion, right after the experimental result and the limitation, you have to list the strengths and weakness of your own method. How and when your algorithm, your method is strong, why they are strong. Alternatively, you need to find out how and when your algorithm is weak. and then also pick up why they were weak and give the roadmap to the reader, to the audience, to the readers. They may follow your paper. Okay, this is almost the serious part of today's topic. And then we just use one slide to share the information. Stay happy and well in China is also very important. We just list several points. So that's quite important. Usually in the most of the laboratory in China, we have several meetings per week. Also the reporting in per week. In the case in my laboratory, we have two meetings per week. Each one is to quickly go through every person. We call it a launch meeting, actually without launch. Just start from 1 p.m. until, well, usually we will last 2 hours, even one person, 5 minutes presentation and 5 minutes Q&A. And then the other thing is you have to submit one report per week. That could be quite simple. Just list what you have done and what's the good result. What is the current challenge or the issues on your progress? What's your plan in the next 7 days? Okay, this is two meetings and one report per week. The other point is how to communicate and stay well with your supervisor. Usually in China, we use a WeChat. It's quite like WhatsApp in the international way. Also maybe in Japan and Korea, they use LINE. Also you can use email or by the phone call. But in China, usually for the hurry situation, I suggest students to use WeChat. Otherwise, it's better to use the email to communicate with your supervisor first. Decide your issue or your case is important or in hurry. They may book the time slot with you by phone call or WeChat to have a face-to-face meeting. So this is the usual case in China. Please do not always communicate with the supervisor with WeChat. You know the reason? Usually for the supervisor, they may take more time on their work, not WeChat. That means they have a lot of and lot of unread message in WeChat. In my case, over hundreds unread WeChat message is normal. I know some of the supervisor, they have over 1,000 unread WeChat message. So that's the reason why your supervisor always delay to reply you and just send the email with a very official format. And if it's possible, you just write down the important and hurry at beginning of the email title. That's quite important. Or otherwise, it's just you go to your laboratory, knock your supervisor's door. Sometimes you may mention, okay, my supervisor is quite busy. I don't know where is him or her. Okay, just send email. And the third thing is important, just try to stay with your lab mate and learn more Chinese language. This is very important because I was a study abroad in Japan. I just follow the rules to stay with my lab mate and then try to learn Japanese. You may find your life is quite colorful and not your own country's friends there. You may have many Chinese friends. Okay, you have the same hobby. Maybe all of you are like football, play the instrument, the music, something else. So that's the point, and you need to find out a way to contribute with your group and then to build up the international culture of your group. In my case, in Japan, when I was taking my master and PhD degree, in our laboratory, we only have a few Japanese students. Maybe for the international students, many of them from China, some of them from US, French, Italia, Sweden, many students from South Asia, like Thailand, Malaysia, Philippines, and some of them from Africa. I know some of my lab mates from South Africa and some other countries. So this is the reason why you are the member to contribute or to build the international environment of our laboratory. For example, the first thing I always ask my student, Yosef, to help others to revise their paper writing in English. Also co-research, work together. Also try to find out the same hobby, to play together, even to eat together. For example, the Chinese spicy food, and just play with the local culture. I paste the two pictures here. For the first one, by now I still do not know the name of this instrument, but I know it's the instrument from Ghana. Why I know this one? Because my baby is only 1.5 years old. Usually we play my baby to the jamboree in this classroom to play the instrument. Suddenly I find out this one. And then I asked the tutor there, what's this? And they told us it's the instrument from Ghana. Okay, at the end, I have one request. So please tell me what's the name of this instrument. Okay, this is the last slide of today's talk. So hope you will enjoy it. And then it's welcome to any kind of question, no matter research or the life in China. Yes, thank you. I hope it's not too late, sorry.
Okay, thank you, Professor. Wow, this is a powerful presentation. At this point, because it's too late, we will take two questions for Professor. Two questions, please, anyone. Just use the raise hand tab and so that I can see you and call you. Two questions for Professor, please. Anyone? Are you all sleeping?
No,
we
are together, okay?
Yes, yes. Okay, so since you're the first person talking, please, do you have
it's
a question?
Time to sleep.
Hello?
Hello. Oh, well, I don't have any questions. I think everything is well presented. I've so much enjoyed it.
Okay.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Okay. Hello. Thank you. So, Professor, somebody just asked in the chat page, what is the ultimate goal of the thesis dissertation? Somebody just asked, what is the ultimate goal of the thesis dissertation?
I can't do this about thesis dissertation. Anna.
Sorry, can you repeat again?
Okay, so the person just asked, what is the ultimate goal of the thesis dissertation? Please, can you come clear? Do you mean, are you referring to undergrad, master's, PhD?
Yeah, that's important.
The person who asked this question, Lana, can you please come clear? Dissertation, PhD, master's, undergraduate.
Ah, okay. Yeah, your PhD, that's quite different. The undergraduate still, the master's also PhD are very important. Maybe I will give all of them. Okay, master?
Yeah, master's.
Okay,
for master's.
Okay. For master's, okay. Well, first of all, this is very good problem. To me, maybe I will explain what is the ultimate goal of the PhD thesis dissertation. usually we say in the PhD level, the main point is you need to find out your own problem and then try to solve those problems with several methods, algorithm. Usually for each of the algorithm or methods, you may publish several papers. This is for the PhD level. Okay, it's clear now. For let's say the normal master student, is you have already fixed the topic, the research scientific problem is fixed, is maybe given by your supervisor. It's not supported by your own. So your master thesis is try to focus on propose a nice or a good algorithm. That's the point. Okay, the existing research area, existing research topic, existing problem, and then try to propose a good algorithm to solve it. This is the goal of master thesis. Let's say for the PhD thesis, your goal is to propose a good research problem. This is one. Am I answered the question?
Okay, thank you. And the last question is, what is the hot topic now related to AI? Can you give examples? That is the next question, Professor.
Okay. I can read those questions. So I will give two examples. Okay, for the AI area itself, when you read top conference or top journals, nowadays the reinforcement learning is very hot topic. What's the reinforcement learning? Reinforcement learning, usually we can say it's a long-term dissertation. Make you try to propose an algorithm. We also call this a robot or agent. Okay, you try to teach this robot can do all of the skill in long term. So this is the very hot nowadays in the AI, no matter the ICML, the NIPS conference, or even the ICCV, CVPR, all of them, nowadays the reinforcement learning are very hot. For example, the top institute, such as the MIT, UC Berkeley in US, the University of Tokyo, all of them are working on this topic. Even, you know, Google, Amazon, Facebook, they work on this topic, reinforcement learning. Okay, the other thing is, what is the hot topic now related to AI? You may know there is a news. So for the Google, they have the Alpha Bell, right? Yeah. They publish a top journal, the Nature. They try to use some AI method to find out to solve the problem in biology. Usually we call that one is a bioinformatics, right? This is another point. Usually for the biology, also the engineering, the autonomous cars, all those things are relevant to the AI is very hot. So nowadays we can say many of research area, they were very, very hot, relevant to the AI, okay? Yes?
Okay, thank you very much, Professor. We really enjoyed your submission. It was, by the way, please, can anybody tell us the name of Professor's babies too? The one he said is from Ghana. Can anyone give us the name? Our brothers and sisters from Ghana.
Okay.
Can you give us the name? You can tell Professor Lee. Yes? Is anybody talking?
Yusufu.
Need Fufu.
Also, we need the WeChat ID of Win Fufu.
Wen Sufu?
Yes.
No, Yusuf.
Oh, Yusuf. You mean Yusuf will know, right?
Yeah, I know. I know he knows, yeah.
Okay,
we need his WeChat ID, please.
Yeah, we wish
How to pronounce that?
Somebody said it's called Maraca.
Maraca, okay. What's the situation to play it? The daily life or some quite unique event?
Okay.
Yeah, it's called Maracas. It's called Maracas.
They are usually
played along other kinds of sound instruments like drums and the gong. Yeah, the name is Maracas. Maracas.
Okay. Thank you, Maraca. Wow. Okay. Well, maybe tomorrow I'll ask Yusuf how to play it, so I can play on my children's class. Okay.
Okay, that's
great. I guess I also can try to answer another question. Mm-hmm. It's from Wasif. Is it Wasif? Wasif.
Yeah.
How to deal with that problem while doing the PhD, right?
Yes.
This is quite a serious problem, you know. Usually, I remember when I was during my own PhD period, I also have the same problem. You know, that's the reason because the PhD is quite hard, a tough time in your daily life. But first of all, you need to know PhD is the most difficult level of your study in your whole life. You need to pay more attention to work on it. No PhD life is, let's say, relaxed. Every PhD student is always nervous, worry about the job, worry about the job hunting. But you just take those nerves, the pressure. That's it to be. It should be like that, but otherwise, how become into different from others who are not PhD? And then once you got PhD degree, you will feel you may face too many and many difficult. You can do anything you want, no matter how difficult it is. And then let's say the methodology to deal with it. The first important thing is just to talk or communicate with your supervisor. This is important. Tell him or her you are in a very bad situation. You need their help, no matter they are busy or not busy. Just try to find out the help. First one, from your own supervisor, professors. The other thing is just really to communicate with your lab mate. They may help you to do your own research. They may help you to label your data in our computer science. They may stay together with you to help you in your daily life. You may find more enjoying stuff there, maybe football, maybe basketball, maybe just eat Chinese spicy food, because in China, especially in Chengdu city, we believe you eat more spicy food, you may feel happy. That's because no reason, just chemistry. Okay? And then in conclusion, just take it easy to recognize that this situation is normal in your PhD life. You may take time and try your best and you can overcome it. There is nothing, just take time. Maybe 3 or 5 years, everything will go, okay? This is very good question. I always want to communicate those my experience to you. but there was no suitable environment. But today is quite good. Quite good chance to tell you, PhD is not easy. Once you choose to take PhD, you need to work hard and enjoy your life, as maybe it will cost 3 or 5, even more years to stay with you. Yes, that's it.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Participant, hello students. The time is far spent and we need to get some rest so that we can start our day tomorrow strong and healthy. I know this is an educative program that all of us would wish that it would continue, but alas, our time is up. Thank you again. Thank you so much, Professor. Thank you, Dr. Kluger-Brown.
You're welcome.
People have blessed us this evening with this amazing presentation. And I believe that every student, whether master's, undergraduate, PhD, we've learned something new today. And I would like to take this opportunity to also thank each and every one of us that was able to turn up for this program. We are so grateful for your time. I mean, it's not easy to spare 2.5 hours of your time to come for a program, but we are so grateful. Thank you very much. I would also like to acknowledge the International Students Office, the ISU of UESTC, for helping us set up this wonderful program. And also to the executive body of the National Union of Ghanaian Students, Chengdu chapter. Thank you so much for this amazing program. And I would like to use this opportunity to tell everyone to look forward to our upcoming workshop, which is slated to be in January, but the date in January and the time has will be communicated as soon as possible. And details of this kind of presentation will be done during that time. So stay tuned for that workshop. Thank you, everyone. I would like to call on Mr. Malik Nkrumah, the president of NUGS-CHENDU, to give us the closing remarks. And Mr. Malik Nkrumah, are you online, please?
Good evening, Honorable Delali. Please, can I be heard?
Yes, please.
Yeah, all right. Can you hear you?
Okay. I think you've already said a lot, so I wouldn't spend my time, but I would like to, on behalf of the chapter executives, to thank Professor Ninshe, the ISO of UESTC, Dr. Benjamin Kluger-Brown, the National President of NUGS-CHINA, the Provincial Coordinator, and representatives of ISU, and all members, ladies and gentlemen, who spent time to join us this evening. This presentation has been a very great one, and it is my pleasure to give the closing remarks for this program. So the program, which was entitled Roadmap to Academic Success 1, had 2 main objectives. That was to educate us, our enlightened members, on how to conduct a literature review, and how to relate well with our supervisors in selecting our topics and having a good academic journey. The seminar, according to Dr. Benjamin Kluger-Brown, choosing the topic and the target audience is very important for every research work. And so, the paper or the topic you choose should also be interested to you as a researcher, which is an added, which will give you more zeal to do a very good work. You also touch on getting a well-defined objective. And this is very important for every academic work. Aside that also, Professor Ninshe came in and also further elaborated on planning a successful meet academic work, where he touched on a topic, how to get your topic, how to define the program or the problem, and also seeking from ideas from not only your supervisor, but also engaging your fellow students in the labs, coordinating with Chinese students to also make their input on your work, which will make it easier for you. We also learned about some online browser website that we can get our literatures from, like the Web of Science, PubMed, and others. And our resource persons actually took us through how we can make a successful search on these engines. And one thing that I really learned today is that in order for you to have a very good academic paper for publication, you need to plan your library. Many a times we finish with our work and then we are now looking for the references. So as researchers, we must always have a library ourselves so that we can always make reference to. And then one other thing that I also learned is that we should always engage our teachers in the polite way, as soon as in the best possible manner, because building that relationship and that cordial relationship is key to our success. And also, I would like to conclude by saying that this has been a remarkable success for this program. It has been a remarkable seminar in every sense, because looking at the participation and members' engagement, we are very grateful and look forward to such engagement in the future. We are hopeful that in our next seminar to partner with the ISU to make it big and also include our international students for larger audience. Thank you so much for gracing our program tonight. So, Honorable Dilali,
I'm done. Okay, thank you, Mr. President. Okay, so Mr. Gerard Mali, are you here? Mr. Gerard
Mali? Yes, I'm here.
Okay, so please close us with a vote of thanks.
Oh, okay. All right. I would like to thank all and sundry for this wonderful time spent on this academic seminar. In fact, I never thought it would be very interesting and engaging as this, but in all, I think we've enjoyed the brief touch on other issues concerning our academic sources. So I would like to thank Professor Ninxie for the time dedicated, leaving all that he has to do behind and then having time with us online to share all his thoughts with us. We promise to work harder based on all his tidbits. And then to our chairman for the academic committee, yes, you've done it all. Thank you very much for all those wonderful tidbits as well. In fact, I never knew that I could use Web of Science for those kind of deep research in terms of gathering my literature. I always focus on the Mendeley, but it turned out that Web of Science can be of much use, and then the other portals as well. And then to all our NUGS members, thank you very much for having time to join us. And it's unfortunate that the sitting capacity on Zoom got full. Maybe next time we'll find a way of dealing with that. And then thank you, the other USTC members who also joined for this program. Thank you for having the time to join us. And then also want to say thank you to all those who also had the links to also join this program from other campuses as well. Thank you very much. As Professor Ninxie said, stay well and healthy in China and in Ghana. God bless USTC, God bless Zhongguo, and God bless our motherland, Ghana. Thank you all.
Thank you. Okay, so good night, everybody. Don't forget what you learned today. Don't forget what you learned from Professor Ninxie, Dr. Kluger Brown. Don't forget, it's very important for your research, okay? Good night, and start new tomorrow. Start fresh, start strong. Goodbye.
Okay, good night.
Bye-bye. Bye, thank you. Living nothing but the Almighty. Just a little jean and a pure white. She never dreamed to ever be nobody wifey. She wanna be everything. Baja artist on me. Now you like a villain cause she caught in a way. Tonight I am walking away. Night of my mind and I cry, yeah, yeah. Tonight I might fall in love. The trend in a night.